Now, any other member would like to ask Judge Feinman any question? I'm going to go to our ranker, Senator Hoylman.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you for those thoughtful questions. You took two or three of mine already. And it's an honor to see you, Judge, and your husband, Robert, and your friends here today. It's a historic first, but only from my perspective, because I've never known someone as well as I do you who's risen all the way to the Court of Appeals. So I'm just so proud of your candidacy. The fact that you are here having come up through the ranks, beginning as a law secretary to a Supreme Court justice, and then to civil court, and to Supreme Court, where you challenged entrenched political powers that at one point or the other opposed your candidacy, and you eventually prevailed and won those powers over all the way to the appellate court and here today. I have to say this before I ask a question, that throughout the years I've known you, you've always been connected to the community. You're not in an ivory tower or hurtling thunderbolts from Mount Olympus. You've been very embedded. Everyone knows who you are. You're unpretentious. One of your friends told me after you're appointed that you were Hamish, just unpretentious, accessible, friendly. And what an enormous advantage for everyday New Yorkers to have someone like you on our highest court looking out for their interests. And in addition to that, I assume they didn't have you in a soundproof chamber out there, but your reputation literally precedes you today. The comments by the representatives from the Bar Association and the trial lawyers, I think, reflect the opinion that your colleagues have of you who sit on the bench, and lawyers who regularly appear before you, the people who know you best. So I think combined with your experience, your writings, your intellectual abilities, as the chair has pointed out, I'm so proud that you're here today. So thank you. So a question. I was wondering, looking at your long record, noting that you once worked for the Legal Aid Society, if you could describe that experience and how you think it will inform your career moving forward and how it has already on the bench.
Well, certainly having worked at the Legal Aid Society, both in Nassau County and then later in the city, I am acutely aware of access to justice issues, and so I think that that's important to keep in mind when a judge is formulating decisions. The fact of the matter is, though, let me be very clear, once you put on the robe, you are not an advocate either for the defendant or the prosecutor. And I think, as the chair has already alluded to, when you look at the totality of my work, I don't think that you can find examples of where I am taking on the role of an advocate for one side or the other. So I don't think there should be any concern about that.
Thank you. And we were provided a copy of a Law Journal article you wrote called Caseload and Trial Capacity Issues in the Criminal Court of the City of New York. It's been a few years since you've been on the criminal bench, but do you have a sense whether these issues that you've identified back then have been addressed since then, from your perspective on the court?
The particular article I think you're referencing was a committee report that was written in the context of the City Bar Association. And it was a report that was designed to address areas where we could improve calendar congestion in the lower criminal court, that is to say, the misdemeanor court in the city. And some of those suggestions were enacted, and it helped decongest what we call the all-purpose part. So I do think that the administrators of the court at that time, this is back in the 90s, undertook to put into effect some of the changes. I'm not just saying this because she's in the room, but the chief judge has undertaken the excellence initiative, which continues to work upon those improvements at improving the expeditious but fair resolution of cases. Her excellence initiative is really having dramatic results and includes some of those issues that we addressed in that report back in the 90s.
And then finally, if I may, with the tragic passing of Judge Abdu Salam, I believe the Court of Appeals no longer has a judge who has sat as a judicial officer in a New York City courtroom. I was just wondering, like, that perspective, I mean, that granular understanding of how our court system works at the lowest level, how do you think that's going to serve you in our highest court?
Well, the court will have judges who come from all parts of the state and, you know, suburban, urban, rural, and that's important because to the extent that we sometimes would opine on procedural issues that come up, whether it's under the CPL, the criminal procedure law, or the CPLR, the civil practice laws and rules, it is important that the judges bear in mind the realities, the practical realities of how those courts operate. And they are organized differently in different parts of the state, either because of particular requirements of the state constitution or the judiciary law, or because of resources. You know, for any number of reasons, things are not done. Business is not always conducted the same way. And so it's always important to bear that in mind when at the highest level you are articulating a rule that's going to have uniform applicability.
Thank you very much, Your Honor.